Hi, Amit.
Hi, Liz.
You're an equity analyst for Goldman Sachs Research covering medical technology. You've had a particular focus on robotic surgery. How's that sector responded to the pandemic?
Robotic surgery was impacted pretty heavily in the second quarter, similar to a lot of other procedure categories, as hospitals really slowed down elective procedures in preparation for COVID patients. But the good news is that the recovery has been happening, you know, steadily every month in the second quarter and into July, and that includes robotic surgery. We're up to about 90% of normalized volume now in kind of the latest data that we look at.
So in what types of surgeries are robotics being used now, and how do you think that might evolve?
You know, when robotics started, we thought this would be useful in cardiology. It turns out that prostate cancer was the first procedure that really took off. That was followed by gynecology, in particular hysterectomy. And more recently, that's been general surgery that's been driving a lot of the growth. And, you know, that's areas like colorectal surgery, but also more benign categories like hernia and gallbladder removal that have really taken off. And then separately, we've seen adoption rates really start to accelerate more recently in hard tissue robotics in areas like total knees and to a lesser extent hips and spine, which are in the earlier days. Going forward, we think that there's really the best way to think about this is on a spectrum of instrumentation. So there's these rigid instruments that are used in the procedures that I just described that basically are, you know, strong instruments with wrists on the ends of them. And then on the other side of the spectrum, there are these snake-like instruments that really can get into parts of the body that we've never been able to get into before with these robotics. I think it's very early days, but that's where a lot of the growth over the next 5 years, I think, is going to start to come from. Kidney stones is going to be a brand new area down the road, colonoscopy. Today, that technology is already starting to be used for lung cancer diagnostics and eventually therapeutics. And so it's a very exciting area in general.
We're also seeing an increase in things like imaging capability and surgical analytics. How do you think things like that might improve outcomes?
Yeah, so maybe the best way to think about that is, in phases. So phase one for robotics over the last 20 years really is just has been about minimally invasive surgery and being able to improve on the ability of the human hand. I think phase two is where we are now, and that's going to be a lot about imaging and improving beyond the ability of the human eye. So we already have things like augmented reality, which is basically taking a CT image and putting it into the console for the surgeon to see on top of what his vision already is. And that's already helping out today and really in the early stages. And in the future, that's going to include things like imaging agents that are going to light up cancer tumors so surgeons can see them and remove them more accurately. It's going to include hyperspectral imaging, which allows to see layers of tissues. So really improving the ability of sight to improve, to take outcomes to a different level. And then there's going to be this phase three, which is about data analytics, augmented reality, and automation, some exciting stuff, which I think is longer term. But training in virtual reality, I think we'll see an impact right away. I think we're already seeing the benefits of machine learning capabilities as well, starting to take off. And eventually what we'll see is some kind of like a GPS system where the surgeon is doing the surgery and there is kind of something, a computer looking over his shoulder in a way to guide him as to whether he's cutting in the right place or not, or in the right location where he needs to be to perform whatever tool utilization he's doing. And then 5 to 10 years down the road, and this is further down the road, you get into some fun kind of automation aspects where I think we'll first see the robot do things like suturing, and then eventually you can imagine it being something like an airplane mode with a pilot where the surgeon is always going to be there, but the robot will end up doing more and more of the procedure as time goes by.
And how do you think the rollout of 5G might affect robotic surgery?
Yeah, I think it could be very important for remote surgery. I think it could be huge. You know, when you think about surgery today, you know, the networks are just not fast enough to move for a surgeon who needs this, you know, absolute precision and even a split second delay in moving a robotic arm remotely just wouldn't work. But with 5G, it could enable that, and we think it very much will. And so that means that remote surgery could actually become a thing where, you know, you have a surgeon sitting in New York potentially performing a procedure in another region. And that's very exciting. I think it could also allow for fewer people generally to be in an operating room setting. And all of this takes on an even more important context nowadays because of COVID. So I think you're going to see an accelerated effort from industry to get this remote capability going for robotic surgery.
Given that, what's your outlook for robotic surgery in the years ahead?
As of last year, there were only, in the US, there were only 900,000 procedures done robotically. That's 5% penetration of what we think is the addressable procedure market. And this is after 20 years. We are expecting an acceleration of growth over the next 10 years. We think by 2025, there'll be 3.5 million procedures in the US. That's about 16% penetration. 7 million procedures by 2030. That's 30% penetration. Just under 20% of operating rooms in the US will probably have a robot in them. And so it's a $4 billion market today that we've got going to $10 billion by 2025 and $17 billion by 2030. Just in the U.S., that's a 10% CAGR for 30 years, through 2030 for 10 years. Very defendable numbers, I think. Worldwide, that's much bigger, $14 billion by 2025, $24 billion by 2030, with really soft tissue, where our conversation was really dominating, but followed by endoluminal and hard tissue as well. You know, those are big numbers that I just threw out, and am I being, you know, too positive, or is the glass half empty here? I mean, we've got quadrupling of the market by 2030, but only 17% procedure penetration. And I think you could argue pretty easily that the 17% could be much higher.
Thanks, Amit.
Thanks, Liz.